Alicia, thank you for being with us. You have been working with the bond process for some years now, and we are very excited to hear from you, particularly how is it organized and structured on European level. Maybe to get an insight from your side about the actual agenda and bond process as in a bit more bird perspective, and then what are the aims, and particularly what is the state of play at European level right now, because afterwards in the next presentation we will hear the Slovenian strategic plan and action plan for this year, so that we can connect the two levels better. Alicia, the time is yours.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Simona. And well, thank you for repeating a bit of the things in English so that I actually also know that it's my turn. And yes, I'm ready to actually talk to you. Before I start my presentation, hi from Germany to all the people behind the screens. I'm very happy to be here and to be able to give you a small input on the state of art of the bond process at the European level. And yes, I will start my presentation and then we will just dive directly into it, I would say. So. Just one second.
Maybe to take advantage of these few seconds, dear participants, during the presentation of Alicia, maybe you will get some questions or things that you would like to have further clarified. In order to express them, you can use the function of Q&A in the webinar mode. So you can write your questions there, and then at the very end of the presentation, we will look at them, and hopefully Alicia can already address some of them.
Perfect, exactly. So yes, my name is Alicia, as I was already introduced by Simona. I'm working at the European Service Center for the Bond Process, and we are basically have the mandate to support the bond process from a European perspective and at European level. But of course, it connects a lot also to what happens at national level. So I will try to give you a very short and brief overview about the state of art. And I will just set my timer to be sure I'm on time. Yes, so the bond process and the European Youth Work Agenda, it is the two big words we are going to work with today during this webinar. But I would kind of like to start first of all, maybe from you, where you are standing right now, because if you are here in this webinar, for sure, you're active in youth work in your country, and probably you are providing, offering some activities, maybe directly with young people, maybe on a more administrative level, maybe you're also advocating for youth work as a field in general. And if you find yourself in those questions I just mentioned, it means you are part of the youth work community of practice. And just to make sure that we are all on the same page when it comes to this word that we will use a lot, the youth work community of practice really means everybody who is connected to this youth work field and working directly with young people, maybe also more on organization level, but it also includes researchers, local communities, the national agencies that are pretty much engaged in this field, but also youth policymakers. So we really mean this field as a large. I think that's kind of important to clarify in the beginning. And yes, I would like to start connecting maybe a bit to your reality, being from those many different realities I might just have mentioned. Maybe you will find yourself in one of those questions kind of listed here. Maybe you're engaged in youth work at the local level. Maybe you're specifically focusing on diversity in your youth work. Maybe you're engaging for quality development, interested in networking or also cooperating with colleagues, but maybe also with people from other countries. Maybe you're among those who are actually engaged beyond the youth work field itself, trying to work more on a cross-sectoral level, maybe to formal education. Yes, maybe you are. Right now, I think a lot of us are probably still working on tackling the crises, the challenges we have from the pandemic, but of course also with everything else happening around us with climate and so on. And maybe you're also among the ones who are actually more supporting youth work from a policy level and being engaged in fostering its cause there. So yes, I guess I hope all of you are actually able to find themselves in one or the other area. And well, good news, if you find yourself in there, it means that the bond process is definitely for you, and you're probably very right in this webinar here today. Because the bond process basically aims at aligning our commitment, also the commitment of all the different stakeholders of the whole Youth Work Committee of Practice, and with the many different interests you might have, as we just saw. It's a lot about connection and cooperation, so also really also creating the space to be able to meet, to discuss, and to see how to commonly tackle challenges we have or improve our work. It's about more strategy, so also trying to find a red line, main issues we really would like to work on all together, nationally, but of course also at a European level. And it's also a lot about framing conditions for youth work, because in the end, youth work can only be as strong as the frame is that we have to actually do our work. And so this is basically the main objectives, I would say, of the bond process, and what's the backbone of the whole idea of the agenda and the bond process. As we are using those two words a lot, maybe just to clarify it, if you're not so familiar with it yet. So basically, we have the European Youth Work Agenda and we have the bond process. And what we can say is this, that the European Youth Work Agenda is basically the strategic framework we have. It's a political document. I will come back to this in a moment. And we have its implementation. So basically bringing the whole thing into action, making it alive, because what is on paper, well, stays on paper if we don't get active within its frame. And this is what we call the bond process. So basically the bond process is the implementation of the European Youth Work Agenda. To give you very shortly some political background, the agenda is, well, I think we can still say quite recent and new. It was established in 2020 as a new strategic framework to further develop and strengthen youth work. So this is really like the overall aim of the whole agenda. It was created during the German presidency of the Council of the EU and the German chairmanship of the Committee of Ministers in 2020. So we had this overlapping presidency back there. And this is basically also why we as German NA are still quite engaged in supporting the whole European process, because it basically goes back to this creation that happened our presidency. I think what's important to know is that it covers the European Union, but also the Council of Europe's geographical territory. So this is very important. It's also based in political documents of both institutions. And in order to make the agenda alive, it needs the engagement of the many. So basically, this is where the whole community of practice comes in, because for implementing the process, it means we really need the engagement of all people being active in the field to make the bond process actually a fruitful process and to make the agenda alive and changing realities in what we do and improving our work. So now the big question is probably nice to have this framework and also nice to have this process, but well, what's the added value, and also how can the different actors with their different tasks actually get active and be part of this process and contribute to it and use it for their own cause? So of course, the list could probably be a lot longer, but just to maybe give you some ideas about what is the added value of the bond process and why it's important to have it. So basically, and I think this is in line with a lot of efforts that have been there before 2020, it's still a lot about understanding of youth work as the common ground for the entire community. So also having this same language, knowing what we talk about when we mean youth work, especially in the European context. It's also a chance to actually bring this European dimension and make use of European opportunities in local youth work, in local realities, but of course also at national level. One very key document, and I will also come back to it in a moment, is the final declaration of the third European Youth Work Convention. So that's the big event that happened in 2020 online, unfortunately, due to the pandemic, and which basically gave kind of birthed the whole bond process and was the starting point of starting to implement it. And this final declaration can be used a lot also as advocacy instrument, because basically it has the political commitment of all the countries and lists a number of activities that are defined as being central to foster youth work. And this means that, of course, it can also be used a lot to connect the own work. Then it's a lot about quality development. I already said cooperation. There are a lot of opportunities to exchange and network, especially at European level when we try to also provide certain platforms. And of course, connecting to this process can also highlight visibility of your own work. And last but not least, at European level, very important to mention that we have major EU funding programs that are deeply connected to the process, and it can also be used as funding instruments for the own work. So, yes, I mentioned the final declaration, and basically, in order to have some major lines within the process, and the process is kind of defined by 8 priority areas. So basically 8 areas that were filled by the whole community of practice at the convention with really concrete measures, and were defined as the most important ones for our field that should be strategically approached and worked on jointly. And you can see the 8 areas here on this nice picture, and I also have some basic information about all the areas within the next slides. I think I will not have time to go very deeply into every single area, so it's really just going to give you a rough picture that there are some documents where you can also read more about it. And of course, I'm also happy to share the presentation afterwards so that you can maybe read a bit more in detail what examples we have here. So right now, I will just give you maybe an overall idea and what stands behind those words of the areas. So the first area is about develop and expand the youth work offer. So here it's really a lot addressing the local level, and it's mostly focusing on strengthening the provision of youth work on those levels, and also basically have youth work being accessible to every young person wherever around Europe this person might live. So this is kind of the dream, I would say, behind this this priority area. And yeah, here you can find some examples, what we think or what the final declaration mentions as possible actions that also can be taken by the whole youth work community of practice. Quality development is the second big area, and I think one that is very important at the moment, also a lot in the field, which is basically tackling better outreach and information about existing support structures and mechanisms, but of course also, targeting at continuously improving our own work and see how we can do better, and also contribute to improving our work as such. Then we have the priority about a common direction for the youth work community of practice. So here the focus is mostly exchanging, exploring, but also having this space to know about each other, to have a view on what we do, what happens around Europe, what happens at national level, and also to use this space to actually bridge gaps or not double work, align our engagement. And so this is mostly connected to this priority area. And then if we talk about the community itself, of course it's also important to have a look beyond the community. This is where we move to the fourth area. Because of course, youth work is not happening in a bubble. It's happening within the society. It's happening connected to a lot of other actors, not being part directly maybe of our field, be it formal education, but of course all the other services also targeting young people. And so basically this area is a lot about finding allies maybe beyond our field, but also seeing where we can actually strategically cooperate to overall better reach out to young people, for example. Then we have the very big area of promotion and recognition, and also this one is an area where a lot of things are happening at the moment, where there's a lot of activity also in the community of practice, because it's about actually making our work more visible and more understood by other people who are maybe not engaged in youth work, more recognized, of course, by the other fields and by society. So I guess that a lot of you can connect actually to the aims behind this priority area. And it's also one of the fields where I think a lot of people are already engaged and working on activities and on kind of getting us on the table and visible all around society. The next area, innovation and emerging challenges, is a lot, I think, also connected to the fact that actually we lived through a pandemic while this whole process and the agenda have been established. Because if something got clear there, that of course youth work can be very vulnerable, young people can be very vulnerable, and we don't know what will come tomorrow. And so this is what this area is about, yes, a lot of issues that are here, like smart youth work, greener youth work, climate change, supporting young people's engagement. But of course, it's also a lot about the question of how can we make youth work being future fit? How can we establish our structures and make sure that no matter what comes, youth work is there and will be able to fulfill what young people ask from us, and also will be, well, still a strong player no matter what comes up within the near future. So I guess one of the very central areas, looking at what the world kind of looks like at the moment. And then last but not least, we move a bit to a more political level, let's say. So the last two thematic priorities are more targeting really the policy level. So first of all, it's a lot about policy frameworks, meaning that of course youth work as such should be an integral part of youth policy. All the policies targeting young people, as we're, as I already said, not only one sector, but also having a lot of things being decided more horizontally, but still, of course, being important for young people. And last but not least, it's a lot about strategic framework for youth work development. And this is maybe the priority addressing more the European level. But of course, I think it can be also here and there being applied to the national levels. That basically, we need a strong vision for youth work, but also strategies in order to implement it to be able to stay a fruitful and well-established working field. Yes, so this was really a quick run through the areas. And as I said, you're warmly invited to read a bit more about it at a later stage, because I know it can be quite overwhelming, especially if you might hear it for the first time. But for the last minutes of my presentation, I would actually like to move to the maybe more interesting part, also knowing how can you actually be part of it and what are your opportunities within the whole thing, and also from European perspective in that sense, what kind of instruments might there be for you to also make use of. And I think then you will see how to connect it, I guess, to what is planned and happening at national level in Slovenia in the second step then. And also here very quickly, so what offers and opportunities you can use for your engagement. So first of all, you can stay informed and also become visible at a European level with what you do. We have a bond process website where you can read more about everything I'm telling right now, but also find some materials that can support you, where you can find more information. This presentation, for example, is available there also to be used in a different context by you. We have a newsletter and social media accounts where you're also warmly invited to let us know about your work and see if maybe there might be an article also about what's going on in your practice and how you connect to the bond process. So basically, yes, it's also channels being available to make your work visible. We're always happy to hear from you and to see how we can support letting others know what is happening around Europe connected to youth work and youth work development. Then you have a huge chance to connect to others and also create movement. So we have several events being organized around the bond process at European level, but as you can see today, also at national level. So also here, you get some information. You are getting informed, and there are a lot more events, of course, also trying to get people meeting on the spot or online and being able to exchange. So you can find more examples on this on the website if you're interested in seeing what already happened in the news, for example. There are working groups on specific topics that you might be interested in joining. And of course, very important, European debates are continuously going on. And if you join events and also contribute your experience, it's of course also already a very strong commitment to the process, because from discussion, it's where we move forward, it's where change happens. So this is of course a very important contribution. Well, you can get involved in your national process as you are here. I think you're already doing it, so I will not lose too much time on this part of the slide. And last but not least, the process is really also inviting the whole youth work community of practice to design own activities, to lobby for youth, your work, but also for youth work in general. And as I said, with the final declaration having a lot of topics in there, you can always use this argument to connect it to what's in there and to really make your own work stronger. Yes. And last but not least, as we are connected to the National Agency for the EU Youth Programs in Germany, I think it's very important to mention that from European level, there are funding instruments connected to the process and also there and available to be used in order to finance certain projects, certain ideas, but also work on certain aspects, maybe beyond the national level, of course. And this would be specifically for the EU, the Erasmus Plus Youth and the European Solidarity Corps program, but also the Council of Europe has some programs like the European Youth Foundation, where there might be some availabilities when it comes to financial means. And of course, in both also, there's also always also content related support, of course, because they are priorities, they are connected to the bond process. So it also means that people there can advise and support also in the implementation. And I will not go too much into details on this, but basically, if you're working in the programs and you can already see the topics being mentioned here as priorities, you can see that it's deeply connected to the bond process, for example, when it comes to inclusion, diversity, but also participation and digital transformation. Yes, and I think that's mostly it. I tried to be on time with the presentation, and I hope there will be some questions to maybe specify the one or the other aspects. Last but not least, here you can see my colleague Elke, who was actually supposed to do the input today, and me. You have our contact details. You can find all the channels that are provided by the European Service Center for the Bond Process. So feel free to visit them to check out what we have there. And on the last slide, you can also find some direct links to some documents that will go more deeper into what I really just roughly presented in those 20 minutes here. And yeah, that's it. Thank you very much. And I think I'm handing back over to Simona to see if there are actually some questions.
Thank you very much, Alicia, for this presentation. I think it gives a very good overview of what the bond process is, specifically thematic priorities. We don't have currently any Q&A questions, but I actually have a question for you. Maybe one of the things, because, you know, in the next part of the presentation, we will focus very much on how the community of practice can get involved on national level and, you know, our strategic plan and also the action plan. But first, and in a lot of examples where the, let's say, more localized or national communities of practice also kind of like get involved to organize on a European level more. Where would you, I don't know, now when you think about it from your head, maybe have one or two examples, just a little concrete inspiration what this could be.
Yes, actually, we hear about a lot of examples from national levels, and they are quite diverse. Maybe this is the first thing to say. So it's not like there's one roadmap that works for everyone, but really the approaches are quite diverse, I would say. And what we experienced so far, for example, at the Bond Process Meetup, so this is like one of the biggest online gathering events, really inviting all the people that are connecting to the Bond Process, is that we feel that there's still also a huge need to understand and see what's happening elsewhere. How do other people organize the process? What are maybe main topics? Because of course, also here it's interesting to see are the topics similar in the different countries, or do specific countries have very specific topics that are quite diverse? And I'm thinking about concrete examples. I mean, mostly I think it's people really sharing how it works in their country, how they started to establish the process. We have countries with working groups. We have countries where it's more, decentralized, I would say, single players trying to push things forward, but then reconnecting kind of to other people from the same country. But I guess we're still in the stage of really establishing the processes and mostly sharing about that. I'm not sure if that answers the question 100%.
No, thank you very much. I think at least one of the things that is quite clear is that a good possibility also for people from Slovenia, from the community of practice, is that they can join the Bone Process Meetup, for example, no? And then already see if there is some possibilities to cooperate across borders for some of the things, maybe even within the Erasmus Plus programs and so on. So thank you very much. I think this was a great short insight into it, and it will also give us the needed framework so that now we can really see, okay, what is happening then here in Slovenia, what are the plans, what is the strategy here. So then, because there's still no questions specified in the Q&A, with this, we will say not just thank you, but also goodbye to you, because we will also switch to Slovenian language. And I know that you will be leaving us. So thank you one more time, and wishing you a very fruitful work on the implementation of the Bone process also for the future.
Thank you. And thank you for the invitation. And I will say goodbye. And have a lot of fun with the second part of the program. And I will be happy to hear about it, actually. I'm sure I will get some insights in what happened. Bye.
Thank you very much. Tako, eden od razlogov, zakaj obe predstavitvi tudi snemamo, je prav ta, da lahko potem tudi še kdo drug, ki danes ni tukaj z nami, vidi, kaj se dogaja na evropski ravni, in zdaj prehajamo v bistvu v tisti del, ki je verjetno za veliko nas tukaj še mogoče bolj domač, a ne pomemben, da vidimo, kaj pa zdaj z Evropsko agendo za mladinsko delo, kaj zdaj s temi osmimi prioritetnimi področji, kakaj so prioritete za Slovenijo, kakaj je naša strategija. Tako da na tej točki bom jaz predala besedo Alešu, da v imenu Urada Republike Slovenije za mladino tudi predstavi konkretno, kaj se v Sloveniji dogaja in se bo dogajalo. Bi pa rada vse opozorila na to, da tale predstavitev bo potem konkretno vezana tudi na nekaj vprašanj, ki smo jih za vas pripravili v orodju Padlet. Tako da bom zdaj kolegico Lauro, ki skrbi za tehnično podporo, prosila, da skozi orodje chat vam podeli dostop do Padleta. Si ga lahko vmes odprete in vidite, da ima orodje v bistvu not opredeljena tri vprašanja, in prvi stolpec, prvo vprašanje je, katera odprta vprašanje in dileme mi odzvanjajo po predstavitvah. In če vmes, ko Aleš predstavlja strategijo in akcijski načrt, že imate nekaj, na kar bi želeli potem opozoriti, vprašati, razjasniti, vas najlepše vabimo, da to sproti že v ta prvi stolpec tudi zapišete. Namreč, kot sem prej omenila, smo v webinar modu in nimamo toliko možnosti za interakcijo direktnega razgovora, tako da bo to naš način, kako bomo izvedeli od vas, kaj vas še posebej zanima, kaj vam ni dovolj jasno, ki bi želeli še dodatne pojasnitve. Tako da vas prosim, da se poskušate to odpreti, in če se bo vmes vam porodila ideja, dilema, vprašanje, ga zapišete. Zdaj pa brez nadaljnega predajem besedo za predstavitev Alešu.
Hvala, Simona. No, jaz bom pa predstavil zdaj slovensko verzijo. In sicer v Sloveniji se je slovenska skupina delegatov takrat na Bonski konferenci odločila, da bosta glavni področji implementacije od tistih osmih, ki jih je predstavila že Alicia, kakovost mladinskega dela in prepoznavanje in priznavanje mladinskega dela. Potem je vse skupaj malo zastalo, vsi vemo zakaj, ampak nadaljevali smo s tem, da smo v marcu 2022 prevedli sklepno deklaracijo Tretje evropske konvencije o mladinskem delu, in takrat je bila ustanovljena tudi državna strokovna delovna skupina, v kateri ste že slišali strani direktorice. Prav tako veste vsi, kako je potekal potem sprejemanje osnutka in čistopisa strateškega načrta za evropsko agendo mladinskega dela v Sloveniji. In pa vaše pripombe, ki smo jih dobili, smo potem čistopis pripravili in šli tudi v pripravo akcijskih načrtov za leto 2023, delno tudi za 2024. In ravno te dve zadevi vam bom danes predstavljal. Hkrati morate povedati, da so vse skozi aktivnosti tudi že potekale. Ne? Tako da vsi vemo, da meseca maja že tudi mladost odmeva, ne? Naokoli. Kot ste videli vsi, poteka že akcija predstavitve mladinskega dela. No, kot sem rekel, dva krovna cilja zajema naš strateški načrt in sicer spodbujanje in razvoj kakovosti v mladinskem delu, ki ima 8 strateških ciljev in pa prepoznavanje in priznavanje mladinskega dela, ki ima 11 strateških ciljev. Posamezni strateški cilji pri kakovosti so, kot piše, prvi je proces poti do kakovosti v mladinskem delu je cilj v nacionalnem programu za mladino. To je seveda že ni sprejet program, ampak je pa vpisan noter kot cilj. Program pa bo sprejet predvidoma konec letošnjega leta, pravi 2023. Drugi strateški cilj je opredelitev kakovosti v mladinskem delu. Hkrati vidite tudi, kako je označeno, ne, krovni cilj 1, strateški cilj 2. Na ta način se označi potem tudi v samo strateškem načrtu in pa tudi v akcijskih načrtih, ki ga bomo pogledali kasneje. Ta dokument, cilj opredelitve kakovosti v mladinskem delu bo dokument, ki bo sprejet junija 2025. Usklajen bo z vsemi relevantnimi deležniki mladinskega sektorja in bo temeljil na učinkih mladinskega dela, tako na posameznika, kot na organizacijo, kot na lokalno skupnost in na širšo družbo. Tretji strateški cilj je opredeljeno, kakovostno mladinsko delo se vključi kot kriterij razpise financiranja mladinskega dela in do oktobra 2025 bomo tiste kriterije, ki jih bomo najbolj izpopolnili do takrat, vključili tako na nacionalni, kot predvidoma na lokalni ravni v razpise za mladinske organizacije. Konec leta 2026 pa bomo na podlagi vseh identificiranih učinkov vzpostavili kriterije in standarde za izvajanje in spremljanje kakovostnega mladinskega dela. In na podlagi njih potem tudi izpostavili izobraževanje in usposabljanje za mladinsko delo, kar je peti strateški cilj. Do leta 2027 bo tako vzpostavljen standardiziran program izobraževanja in usposabljanj in pa tudi sistem financiranja le-teh. Še naslednji cilj, ki je redno periodično beleženje izvajanja mladinskega dela. Tukaj gre za nekak win-win situacijo, tako za nas, kot za vas, kot organizacije. Želimo, da vas beleženje pa spremljanje ne obremeni preveč. Hkrati pa rabimo tudi mi nekatere podatke, da lahko ohranjamo in razvijamo kakovost mladinskega dela in konec konca tudi snujemo ostale politike in naprejšnje korake naprej. Hkrati bi pa radi, da te podatke, ki jih vi zbirate preko tega orodja, ki bo razvito in enotnega sistema beleženja, lahko uporabljate tudi sami. Tako pri evalvaciji, kot pri načrtovanju vašega dela in da vam bojo seveda pomagali pri poročanju. Planirano je, da bo do leta 2027 razvito orode in enotni sistem beleženja in spremljanja izvajanja mladinskega dela. Sedmi strateški cilj, v bistvu odgovor na to, kaj organizacije potrebujete za kakovostno izvajanje mladinskega dela. In do leta 2027 naj bi bilo vzpostavljeno podporno okolje za izvajanje kakovostnega mladinskega dela, tako na nacionalni kot na lokalnih ravneh. Poleg povezav z vsemi drugimi že omenjenimi cilji, je tukaj povezava tudi spremembo zakonodaje. In o tem bomo malo kasneje še malo več pogovorili, ampak v osnovi gre za to, da naj bi spodbujali kakovost s povečevanjem sredstev tako za mladinsko infrastrukturo kot za zaposlovanje mladinskih delavcev in podobno. Hkrati pa bi s grajenjem spodbudnega okolja pokril tudi sive lise, torej območja, kjer trenutno v Sloveniji mladinskega dela ni. Osmi cilj, zadnji strateški cilj pri kakovosti, govori o spremljanju kakovosti in krepitvi prepoznavnosti mladinskega dela. Tukaj bi je planirano, da do leta 2028 se ustanovi agencija oziroma inštitut, ki bi redno spremljala in analizirala družbene učinke mladinskega dela, tudi s pomočjo tistega urodja, ki je bilo vzpostavljeno prej. Hkrati bi pa tudi delala različne raziskave in s tem bi mi dobili bazo in tudi vi za aktualizacijo ukrepov in odzivanje na aktualna družbena stanja. Kot vidite, že zdaj, ko govorim, se veliko ciljev med seboj prepleta, so vsebinsko prepleteni ali pa nekateri sledijo drug drugemu, nekateri so odvisni drug od drugega, tako da to je tudi jasno razvidno, mislim, da v strategiji in tudi v akcijskih planih. Če gremo sedaj na drugi krovni cilj, se pravi na prepoznavnost in priznavanje mladinskega dela, je prvi strateški cilj to, da mladi, predvsem srednješolci, vedo, da obstaja v njihovem kraju mladinske organizacije in programi mladinskega dela, v katere se lahko vključijo. Ta cilj ne bi bil resničen čim prej, ampak od 2023 naprej se bo aktivno delalo na temu, da bodo vedeli in da bomo lahko tudi spremljali trend, koliko srednješolcev je seznanjenih s tem. Zdaj, zakaj srednješolci? Videli smo raziskave in tudi odziv z terena je pokazal, da so v bistvu najbolj zmozljiva ciljna skupina mladih, hkrati pa, če začnemo delati pri njih, nam bo potem tudi oni bili tista baza, ki bo pol do 29. leta bila vključena v samo mladinsko delo. Tukaj smo že tudi pol to povezani s povečevanjem udejstvovanja mladih v mladinskem delu, a ne, to je ta drugi cilj. Kot ko sem rekel, merili se bo od konca leta 2023, je pa tudi povezan s tem, da bo vzpostavljeno podporno okolje in pa sistem spremljanja. Tretji strateški cilj, formalno izobraževanje, prepozna dodano vrednost povezovanja z mladinskim delom. Bom več povedal o tem pri predstavitvi akcijskega načrta. Gre seveda za komplementarnost s formalnim izobraževanjem, tudi direktorica vam je prej že namignila, kaj smo do sedaj storili. Veliko dela nas pa še čaka. In tako, kot sem rekel, že letos smo veliko naredili. Začetek je 2023. Komuniciranje učinkov mladinskega dela različnim deležnikom, tudi o tem bomo še govorili, do leta 2025. Je cilj, da se poznavanje mladinskega dela v širši družbi že zaznavno izboljša, začel pa se je letos oziroma lansko leto s prenovo portala mlad.si, nadaljuje pa se delno tudi s tem, kar sem že prej pokazal, iz prepoznavnosti mladinskega dela z mesecem majem in odmevom mladosti in tudi druge akcije, kot boste videli, so še planirane. Peti strateški cilj, redno periodično spremljanje mladinskega dela, deležbe učinkov, trend prepoznavanje za komuniciranje navzven. Tudi o tem sem že prej govoril, gre za urodje in poenoten sistem beleženja, ki bo pomagal poleg vseh ostalih stvari, ki sem ga povedal, sem jih povedal, tudi k temu, da se bo lažje komuniciralo mladinsko delo navzven do ostalih zainteresiranih javnosti. Šesti cilj, zasebni sektor prepozna vrednost mladinskega dela in ga podpira. Do junija 2027 je predvideno, da se bo vzpostavilo sodelovanje z Gospodarsko zbornico Slovenije in Obrtno zbornico. Spodbujali se bo, da bi izvajali medsektorske projekte in da, kot vemo, vsi mladi kompetence pridobljene v mladinskem delu uspešno uporabljajo kasneje tudi na trgu dela in tudi v tej smeri bo šlo s sodelovanje pri samim zasebnim sektorjem. Naslednji cilj je sedmi cilj, odločevalci razumejo, kaj mladinsko delo je in kaj obsega, prepoznajo tudi učinke in znajo ločiti od ostalih podobnih pol. Že v okviru EGL projekta, se pravi Europe Goes Local, podobna zgodba poteka, se pravi, gre za izobraževanja javnih uslužbencev o pomenu mladinskega dela. Mi bi to želeli nadgraditi in tudi ne samo na lokalnih ravneh, ampak tudi na sami državni ravni. tako da bi bili do avgusta 2027 vzpostavljena redno izobraževanje vseh javnih uslužbencev in tudi izdan slovarček terminologije mladinskega dela, ki bi ga lahko pri svojem delu redno uporabljali. Sledi osmi cilj, mladinski celovci, delovci in mladinske organizacije so ponomočni za predstavljanje učinkov mladinskega dela. Tako, kot sem že prej govoril, ta cilj se pokriva iz ustanovitvijo teh izobraževanj za mladinsko delo in bo vzpostavljen modul ekstra za to izobraževanje in to do junija 2024. Deveti strateški cilj, spremembo normativnega okvira za mladinsko delo. O tem več govoril spet kasneje pri akcijskem načrtu, ker je eden težjih orehov, ki se ga lotevamo in je pa vse skozi tudi ta v teku. Deseti cilj je, mladinski delavec je cenjen poklic in omogoča karierni razvoj. Do leta 2025 želimo, da bo razvit sistem, ki bo omogočal da se mladinski delavec razvija karierno in da dobi ta sistem tudi študijske in normativne okvire in da se potem lahko spremlja celoten potek tega in sproti izboljšuje tam do leta 2032 in omogoča, da resnično gradimo kariero tudi v mladinskem delu. 11. cilj, mladi znajo zavestiti pridobljene kompetence, jih znajo izraziti in uporabiti v prihodnje. V ta namen se bo do leta 2024 razvil orodje oziroma toolbox z metodami in pa tudi ustanovljen bo modul pri izobraževanju, ki sem ga že omenil pri prvem krovnem cilju. Zdaj, če nakratko povzamem celoten strateški načrt. Vizija je do leta 2027-2032, da je mladinsko delo ima določene standarde, s katerimi zagotavljamo in dokazujemo pozitivne učinke mladinskega dela, je priznano in prepoznano v širši javnosti. To je nekako povzetek strategije. Kar bi rad poudaril, je to, da gre za proces, da bodo vedno s tekom tega procesa potekale sprotne evalvacije, prilagajanje in aktualizacije glede na stanja, ki bodo takrat in pri tem boste vi vse skozi del dogajanja vključeni. To nas že pripere potem do akcijskega načrta implementacije. Dobili ste ga tako kot strateški načrt tudi ob prijavi na webinar. Tam je bil razporejen kronološko po aktivnostih, jaz bi ga pa danes predstavil na način, da posamezne aktivnosti združimo pod posameznimi cilji. Kar bi rad poudaril, no, to, kar vidite, da odgovornost tako pri strateškem načrtu kot pri akcijskem načrtu je odgovornost na posameznih organizacijah in posameznikih. To pomeni, da ta organizacija pelje celoten proces, ki je vezan na ta posamezen cilj ali aktivnost, da pri strateških ciljih pripravi akcijske načrte in da pri tem vključuje tiste deležnike, ki se na sam proces nanašajo in na sam cilj ali pri sami aktivnosti so relevantni. Zdaj pa kar, če gremo na opredelitev kakovosti v mladinskem delu. Za letošnje leto je planirana raziskava, ki trenutno že teče, mapiranje obstoječega stanja, tako kakovosti kot podpornega okolja. Do srede junija ne bi bili zdani izsledki in državna delova skupina bo na njihovi podlagi dosegla nek uvodni dogovor o kakovosti, ampak to bo samo en okvir, ki bo omogočal, da poženemo kolo naprej, da se odvijajo tudi ostali procesi in ostali cilji in aktivnosti, ki so povezani s tem in so odvisni od tega, kako so določeni okviri kakovosti. Ni pa to dokončna stvar, ni to dokončen dokument in s časom se bo to preoblikovalo potem v tist dokument, ki je bil mišljen za 2025, pa tudi ta se bo potem redno updateal in prilagajal. Kot sem rekel, sprejet bo tudi nacionalni program za mladino, katerega del je bonski proces. Na temo bonskega procesa pa bo letos organiziran tudi nacionalni posvet mladinskega sektorja, ki bo konec leta. Drugi pomemben cilj je izobraževanje in usposabljanje za mladinsko delo, ki je odvisno od tega, ne, kakšne kakovost se bo postavil, kakšen kakovosten okvir se bo postavil. In tukaj boste, kot vidite iz samih aktivnosti, povabljeni k sodelovanju pri pripravi učnega načrta. Ustanovljena bo operativna delovna skupina, ki bo pravila desk research že obstoječih modelov za mladinske delavce in na podlagi dokumenta kakovostnega mladinskega dela potem postavila okvir. Mapirale se bo že organizacije, večinoma so aktivnosti zastavljene tako, da se bo najprej pogledalo že obstoječe stanje in potem se bo na podlagi njega izvajale stvari naprej. In kot sem rekel, povabljeni boste, da sodelujete tudi vi. Sledi redno periodično beleženje izvajanja mladinskega dela, se pravi, to je tisto orode, ko sem že govoril o njem, in pa tudi agencija je končni cilj, ki bo uporabljala podatke tega orodja. V sklopu akcijskega načrta je mišljeno, da bomo oblikovali evalvacijski odbor, ki bo pregledal že obstoječe sisteme spremljanja in vzpostavil potem skozi proces enotni sistem in začrtal delo, kako bo potekalo. Evalvacijski odbor bo sestavljal predstavniki mladih, mladinskih delavcev, odločevalcev, lokalnih skupnosti, skratka vseh pomembnejših deležnikov mladinskega sektorja. Obenem poteka tudi vzpostavljanje novega digitalnega orodja za beleženje in spremljanje mladinskega dela in učinkov. V planu pa je tudi mapiranje že obstoječih sistemov, se pravi logbook, evidenčnik, drugi sistemi, ki jih uporabljate, in tudi novo orode bo seveda evalvacijski odbor vzel pod drobnogled. Cilj, ki ga bomo naslovili že v letošnjem akcijskem načrtu, je tudi vzpostavljeno podporno okolje za izvajanje kakovostnega mladinskega dela na nacionalnih in lokalnih ravneh. Poleg vseh aktivnosti prejšnjega cilja, ki sem jih naštel in tudi omenil že raziskavo, ki poteka do junija, se ponovno navezujemo na zakonske spremembe, ki so drugače tudi same zase svoj cilj, tako da bomo o njih na koncu spregovoril. Potem pa prehajamo že do krovnega cilja 2, do prepoznavnosti in priznanosti mladinskega dela. Mladi, predvsem srednješolci, vedo, da obstajajo v njihovem kraju mladinske organizacije in programi mladinskega dela, v katere se lahko vključijo. Načrtovanje, pregled aktualnega stanja in ocena udeležbe srednješolcev, analiza dobrih praks in na podlagi vsega tega se bodo organizirali infodnevi v srednjih šolah, katerih namen bo seznanjanje mladih z mladinskim delom in pa z organizacijami iz njihovega lokalnega okolja. Pripravila se bo tudi publikacija, ki bo izšla iz analize dobrih praks in pa kasneje do leta 2024-2025 predstavila tako publikacija kot priporočila dobrih praks srednjim šolam in mladinskim organizacijam. In to bo nekakšen okvir sodelovanja organizacij mladinskega sektorja in srednjih šol. To se navezuje tudi na to, da formalno izobraževanje prepozna dodano vrednost povezovanja z mladinskim delom. Kot je bilo že omenjeno, tukaj je v bistvu največ aktivnosti do zdaj potekel, že direktorica je omenila predstavitev mladinskega dela ravnateljem vseh srednjih šol. V avgustu je planiran posvet z mentori dijaških skupnosti, tudi tukaj je seveda organizacija infodnevov v srednjih šolah, ki se bo začela jesen zima 2023. Tudi mlad.si se bo dodal na posamezne spletne strani srednjih šol in pa, kar je morda najbolj pomembno, vzpostavile se bo usposabljanje za učitelje v mladinskem delu in pa v pomenu neformalnega izobraževanja in metodah mladinskega dela, ki se bodo vodila tudi na način neformalnega izobraževanja z njegovimi metodami. komuniciranje učinkov mladinskega dela različnim deležnikom, kot ste videli, že poteka, a ne, osnova je mlad.si. Kar je pa morda najbolj za poudarte, pa to, da se bo izvedel komunikacijski načrt in sicer grajene blagovne znamke mladinskega dela. To bo v bistvu celostni paket z enotnim CGP-jem in naborom komunikacijskih orodij, ki bo nagovarjal različne javnosti in različne ciljne skupine in v bistvu bo to tista osnova, s katero bomo resnično pripomogli do resnično prišli do tega in pripomogli k temu, da bo mladinsko delo res prepoznavno in priznano tudi v širši javnosti. Del eni od ciljnih skupin bo tudi odločevalci, tako da je tukaj tudi ta prva aktivnost blagovna znamka. Pri tem cilju odločevalci razumejo, kaj mladinsko delo je in kaj obsega, se pravi tudi njegove učinke, ter znajo ločiti od ostalih podobnih pol. Vsi smo že videli, da velikokrat pride do tega, da se pri določenih odločevalcih zamenjuje posamezne pojme, da se zamenjuje čiste osnove mladinskega dela, tako da naš cilj je, da bodo tako odločevalci kot vsi javni uslužbenci toliko izobraženi v mladinskem delu, da bojo vedeli, zakaj gre. Saj osnove, da bodo vedeli, tako da za ta namen se bo razvilo izobraževanje za različne skupine javnih uslužbencev o pomenu mladinskega dela in pa do 2024-2025 se bo že izvedla tudi testna izobraževanja, tako za občinske uslužbence kot za državne. Mladinski delavci in mladinske organizacije so opolnomočeni za predstavljanje učinkov mladinskega dela. Tudi to je ključnega pomena, zaradi tega, ker ravno s tem, ko bomo predstavljali učinke mladinskega dela, bomo pripomogli k temu, da se bo tudi videli, k čemu mladinsko delo pripomore in dvignilo njegovo prepoznavnost. Tudi tukaj bo oblikovan ekstra učni modul v sklopu izobraževanj, ki sem že omenjal. To pa nas vodi potem do naslednjega cilja, ki pa je sprememba normativnega okvirja za mladinsko delo na nacionalni in lokalni ravni z namenom večje podpore mladinskemu delu. Kot sem rekel, že prej je to morda največji izziv. Pravniki radi rečejo, da se zakone spreminja s tresočo roko, predvsem zato, ker čez celoten proces ni odvisno vse od tistih, ki vložijo spremembe, ampak se lahko še marsikaj spremeni, tako da je lahko izid zelo negotov. Zdaj, planu je, no, in to je tudi edini zakon, ki lahko URSM kot urad, kot pristojno telo vloži predlog spremembe, da se spremeni zakon o interesu v mladinskem sektorju. Hkrati pa bi si želeli, ker se pač mladinsko delo dogaja predvsem na lokalnem okolju, da bi tudi v zakonu o lokalni samoupravi in pa v zakonu o financiranju občin prišlo do tega, da bi uvedli določene spremembe. Je pa vse skupaj vezano predvsem na politično voljo, na ugodno klimo in zadostno večino in tako, kot sem rekel, izid je lahko zelo negotov. In če zaključim iz aktivnosti, ki bo vplivala na vse cilje, to bo v pripravi je metodologija za širšo državno raziskavo v mladinskem sektorju. Predviden rok, da bo metodologija pripravljena, je do decembra 2023. Potekala bo raziskava po vzoru raziskave Mladina in bo v bistvu ta prva raziskava mladinskega sektorja v Sloveniji. In ta širši in globji pogled nam bo pol v bistvu omogočil, da bomo še toliko lažje delali vse nadaljne premike v zvezi z bonskim procesom. In bo lepo dopolnil vse, kar do zdaj poteka že. Kar pa najbolj bistveno je pa to, da vsi deležniki mladinskega sektorja implementacije delujemo skupaj, torej z roko v roki. In tukaj vas vabim, da sodelujete, da predlagate sodelovanje svoje delovni skupini. Že to, da ste danes tukaj, dokazuje, da vas stvar zanima, da sodelujete pri posameznih aktivnostih, akcijskih načrtov in pri raziskavah, in seveda boste tudi sooblikovali vse rezultate implementacije, da bomo skupaj prišli do kakovostnega, prepoznanega in priznanega mladinskega dela. Zahvaljujem se vam za pozornost in nam vsem skupaj želim srečno na naši skupni poti. Hkrati pa, če imate kakršnekoli pripombe, predloge, prosim na mail s pripisom Bonski proces, dosegljiv pa sem tudi po telefonu. Tukaj so moji kontakti in pa stran Bonskega procesa, ki jo je že prej pokazala tudi Ališija. Tako da to je z moje strani vse. Hvala lepa.